You've probably heard wildly varying opinions about statins. Your own doctor may even refer to statin naysayers as fringe lunatics, conspiracy nuts, or a death cult. So how do you know who to believe? It's not easy to figure out, so let's look at that. So how can we know the truth about statins? After all, our doctors have that MD after their name, and shouldn't we listen to them rather than some random YouTuber on the internet? Well, in fact, if you don't have the time or the inclination to look into it more deeply, you probably should listen to your doctor. In the universe of possibilities, usually when you don't have any expertise in an area, listening to the experts is the right way to go. You'll be right more often than wrong. But let's not leave it there. If we do want to look deeper, how do we get into it? Well, we'd like to listen to a disinterested third party. And by disinterested, I'm going to read this definition from the Cambridge English Dictionary. And that is having no personal involvement or receiving no personal advantage and therefore free to act fairly. That's certainly what you would want in any advisor that you have. So who's disinterested? Is it the drug companies? Well, they have a financial obligation to their stockholders. A lot of people don't realize that that is their first obligation. It is not to the patients. Is it the statin advocates? Well, many of them are actually funded by the drug companies. Others, even if they're not funded, may have an emotional commitment to the position that they've staked out. And the same can be true of statin hesitators. They're not funded by the drug companies, but they have an emotional stake in defending a position that they've staked out. Is it me? Well, hardly. I'm on the record. My very first video posted, I stated in it that I have an anti-statin bias. So I'm not disinterested in that sense. Is it your doctor? Well, you'd hope your doctor would be, but doctors are under all sorts of pressures and incentives to prescribe statins. Some doctors have even claimed that if they fail to recommend a statin for a patient who qualifies and something happens to that patient, some cardiovascular event, well, then that doctor can be in a lot of trouble for that. So let's look at the two camps, the two opposing sides in this, what they sometimes call the statin wars. I'm going to call them advocacy and hesitancy. For this discussion, it's more nuanced than that, but we're just going to go with that for now. Got to realize that these opinions are not normally distributed, and what I mean is there's not a bunch of people in the middle with maybe some extremists on each side. It's actually a bimodal distribution like shown in this graph. Statin hesitancy is a minority opinion. Statin advocacy is the mainstream majority opinion. So we have a right to ask, an obligation to ask, is statin hesitancy a nutjob conspiracy? I mean, I don't mean to sound flippant, but we actually have to ask that. It's a serious question. So let's look at some reasons to say yes, they are, and some reasons to say no, they're not. On the yes side, it is a small group of vocal individuals. There aren't large medical associations coming out against statins. There's a core set of statin hesitant authors, and you'll see them over and over again, either in their papers or in their YouTube videos. It's somewhat of an echo chamber in that regard. That is kind of a red flag sometimes that you're into a conspiracy theory. Now, I do see some organizations that have some ideology to promote, they might come out against statins. I'll watch a video and say, hey, this is pretty good. This group here is given a balanced look at it and they seem to be leaning away from statins. And then I'll find out that they're selling some supplements or they're trying to push something like a vegan diet or something like that. So that's the only time I see organizations coming out against it. They are going overwhelmingly against the mainstream medical position. Another red flag. They sometimes oversimplify or misunderstand statistics, like the absolute risk reduction versus relative risk reduction. Well, we know that the drug companies misrepresent it by using the relative risk reduction to make it sound better than it is. But in fact, if you watched my video on absolute risk reduction versus relative risk reduction, the statin hesitators actually overstate their case by misusing absolute risk reduction and not considering time frames, not considering the individual's risk level. On the no, they're not nut jobs side of the argument, well, they do publish in respected peer-reviewed medical journals, such as the BMJ, that's a British medical journal. It's not without controversy. There was an article published and somebody from the statin advocacy camp raised a big stink, tried using all their political power to have that article suppressed. So that does mean they're beginning to be heard, and at least partly because they're playing by the modern day rules of science, that is to publish in peer-reviewed journals and to publish meaningful results. Many of them are highly credentialed and often respected practicing cardiologists. Okay, so it's not just, you know, some guy sitting in his office who's a software engineer by trade, such as me. They also expose legitimate conflicts of interest among the researchers or the promoters, and they actually find issues with their research, or they're able to analyze the research to show at least that it's not showing what the headlines, the simplified headlines written by journalists might tell us. So on the basis of this, I'd have to say they're not a nut job conspiracy theory. They may not be right, but they're a voice that has to be respected and treated like any other voice in the scientific community, and that is they put their ideas up for peer review, and you have the opposing parties look at it and explain their case. Another thing to be aware of is how questions about statins are framed. Here's a diagram of the various biochemical pathways in the liver's creation of cholesterol. I'm going to give like a top level view. One way to look at this is the complexity and sheer number of biochemical reactions involved. A person could legitimately use this analysis. You could say hundreds of researchers have worked out the chemical pathways for cholesterol production. From this knowledge, statins were developed to prevent the overproduction of cholesterol. And then they could ask, shouldn't you reduce your cardiovascular risk by taking statins? Now, this is a statin advocacy framing of the issue. Let's look at it from a different perspective. Same diagram. Statins come in at the top, reducing some of the earliest reactions in the chain. A medication that can do that will certainly reduce the output of the cholesterol at the other end of the chain, but notice these side items. They too will be effective, reduced, probably in the same proportion that the cholesterol is reduced. So we can frame the question this way. Is it a good idea to take a chemical developed by a for-profit company that interferes with the normal function of your liver for the rest of your life? Well, same diagram showing the same chain of processes, but with a statin hesitant assumptions built into the question. Another thing to ask yourself, are you reacting emotionally to the issue? You know, how can you know better than your doctor? Well, I think that's asking the wrong question. It's more important to ask this. Is your doctor treating you, or is your doctor treating her patient population? Because the treatment could well be different. If your doctor's treating her population, then success is just a statistical thing. One YouTube doctor, who seemed to be otherwise fairly balanced on the question of statins, said in one of his presentations that if he gives 1,000 people statins and 200 of them avoid a heart attack as a result, then it was a no-brainer to give it to them. He saw that as, you know, plus 200. Whereas I see 800 people taking a drug they don't benefit from. And unless this group is a very high risk, 200 is probably an exaggeration. It would be more like 100 out of 1,000 may benefit, not 200. We might also ask, what's the right cholesterol level for you? This all-cause mortality graph that I brought up in another video shows mortality is minimized around a level of 220. But that's another population statistic. I suspect that if we could somehow know what the right level is for each individual, and that's beyond our understanding right now, the population would fall into a normal distribution where for some people a little higher than average would be their sweet spot, while for others would be lower. It certainly wouldn't be everybody should be under 200, the lower the better. I mean, that just goes against all the studies and all the statistics. Now, when they're talking about cardiovascular events only in isolation, yeah, you can make a case that lower down to maybe around 200, maybe a little bit lower, maybe better. But when it comes to all-cause mortality, and that's what we really should care about because dead is dead, around 220 seems to be that minimal all-cause mortality. So we need to frame our main question differently. It's not about who to believe or not. Both camps are working with the same data. Mainstream medical researchers study statins from a population perspective, and that's okay. That's what they're trying to figure out. But that shouldn't be translated directly into treatment for individuals. You're not 20% of a population or 80% of a population. You're a single whole individual. Your own quality of life and related values enter into it. If, for example, you have small children, well, maybe you'll put up with a little bit of a decrease in quality of life if it makes you think that you're more likely to be around to support them. For somebody else, the degradation in the quality of life, if there is one, just might not be worth it. And there's actually been studies where they tried putting numerical values on quality of life as if that has any validity and if that can matter to an individual. So your treatment really should be tailored to your values, with those population statistics giving you, not your doctor, some measures maybe to decide by, And to do that, your doctor needs to give you meaningful statistics, which requires they understand them and accurately convey them to you. And I'm convinced most doctors don't understand how the statistics work. So what's the answer of who to believe? Well, after you've done your research, believe yourself. Believe your comfort level with the decision to take or not take the statins. If you have no adverse effects, you don't mind the cost, and think there's a benefit for you, well, go for it. Be warned, you might not recognize the side effects, but if they're not all that bad, maybe you don't care. The flip side is that you shouldn't feel pressured or browbeaten or made to feel irresponsible or gullible or stupid if you decided that they're not for you. And certainly no doctor should drop you as their patient if you refuse or even get the idea that they're allowing you to get off statins if you're currently on them. It's up to you. As usual, I'm going to ask you to please do the usual things to help the channel out, the like, comment, subscribe, that sort of stuff. And if you can do it without exposing personal information about yourself, tell me your personal story in the comments below. Thanks for listening.